Tonight, the incoming administration of Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says their first 100 days in office would not be enough to bring down the rising prices of basic goods. The incoming socio-economic planning secretary says now is not the right time to raise taxes to pay for the country's staggering debt. The Philippines logged its highest daily increase of new COVID-19 cases in almost 2 months. And Filipinos urged to remember and honor the country's heroes ahead of Independence Day. Good evening, I'm Stanley Palisada. In the headlines and on our broadcast tonight, rising commodity prices ahead of the new president. The incoming administration of President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says it is impossible to bring down the costs of basic goods in its first 100 days in office. Weng Hidalgo has tonight's top story.
Eatery owner Melissa Binondo can't help but impose a 5 peso increase in all their meals. She says this is all due to the increasing prices of commodities.
Kapag yung nakaubos, sigurado may tubo kami. Pero kapag hindi nakaubos, may maliit na tubo, meron din naman na pag hindi nakaubos, meron din namang sakto lang, pangpuhunan.
Binondo says, these days, she rarely gets to save something for emergency.
Mahirap mag-budget ng pera ngayon, sobra. Kasi may mga expenses ka pa na bayad ng bahay, kuryente, tubig, pasweldo mo pa, tapos gasto sa mga bata.
Binondo's customers understand her problem and find the 5 peso increase reasonable.
Kailangan din nilang gawin yun eh. Kasi lahat ng bilihin tumataas. Kaya naiintindihan din namin na magtataas din sila ng paninda nila. Kasi kung hindi nila gagawin yun, malulugi naman sila.
All these extra costs are due to the skyrocketing prices of fuel products. Jeepney and delivery drivers are calling on additional fare hike per kilometer and the suspension of excise tax.
Sana po ma'am, may bababa po yung diesel. Gumanda naman yung biyahe namin, ma'am. Saka taasan naman po sana kahit konti yung pamasahe, dapat per kilometer po. Gaganda rin na po yung kita namin mga driver. Pagod kasi.
Incoming Department of Trade and Industry Secretary Alfredo Pascual says it is impossible to bring down the prices of goods in the first 100 days of President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. Pascual said people have to look for alternatives and just avoid unnecessary expenses. Pascual added the country should focus more on multiplying food supplies from the local producers. The incoming trade chief also wants to keep a close eye on traders to ensure they will not take advantage of the oil price hikes. He says he will implement a price monitoring scheme which includes a review of price hike requests.
Babantayan natin dyan eh yung hindi na magdagdag yung mga traders dun sa normal nilang profit na pinapatong nila sa cost ng produkto. Ang hirap, yun nga, yung tumataas na nga ang presyo, sumasakay pa para i-increase ang profit at lalong tumataas ang presyo.
Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry President George Barcelon believes if the Russia-Ukraine crisis ends next month, fuel prices might go down, which will have a domino effect on the prices of goods. But for now, they are just going with the flow as the situation is really affecting the oil prices in the global market.
Kung talagang hindi kaya ng consumer, hindi naman na tinutodo nila yung price increase. But natapat ko sa inyo, kailangan may price increase din. Eh kung wala, kakapusin tayo ng mga essentials.
The PCCI says it has asked its members to hold off any price adjustments following the string of pump price hikes and the looming power rate increase. But Barcelona was quick to note while they understand the situation of the consumers, some of their members may have no choice but to adjust their prices. Weng Hidalgo, ABS-CBN News.
Improving the tax administration, helping small and medium enterprises, and improving the supply of goods. These are just some of the plans of the economic team of the incoming Marcos administration to address the country's unprecedented debt and rising inflation. More from Joyce Balancho.
Incoming Socio-Economic Planning Secretary Arsenio Balisacan believes now is not the right time to raise taxes. Earlier, outgoing Finance Secretary Carlos Dominguez III recommended to the next administration the imposition of new taxes to expedite the payment of debts, which now ballooned to almost 13 trillion pesos. The Duterte administration has contributed a lot to the country's debts as it needed funds to address the COVID-19 pandemic. Balisacan says there can be other ways to increase government revenues.
Dapat nang na response natin dito ay hindi matatamaan ng husto yung mga mamahihirap. This is the wrong time to raise taxes. Yeah. Lalo na kung ito'y mas sa mga basic necessities, iwasan natin yon habang ito'y napaka-uncertain yung sitwasyon sa labas.
He says improving tax administration and proper spending of government funds are also good solutions.
I always like to believe there's more with less. I mean, yung kahit man maliit yung total spending mo, kung ginasto mo sa tamang paraan at ini-prioridad mo doon sa yung spending mo sa mga talagang kinakailangan, you can still achieve more.
Balisacan also plans to boost the agriculture sector so the country would depend less on imported goods.
Wala akong alam na country na nag-succeed sa agricultural development without very strong research and development strategy.
Incoming Trade Secretary Alfredo Pascual, for his part, says he will prioritize helping small and medium enterprises. He also sees the need to strengthen the e-commerce sector as the pandemic has changed the way people shop. Pascual also likes to improve the supply of goods to bring down the prices.
Itong pagtaas ng presyo, nakasalalay, tinatawag na imported inflation. Napakahirap kontrolin yan. Kaya ang sinasabi ko nga, kailangan maging resourceful tayo at creative in addressing this problem.
Groups comprising consumers and businessmen express their support to Pascual as the next DTI secretary.
You will get our support in your leadership. Impact if necessary in your nomination processes, confirmation nyo. I have already requested some board trustees to agree with our letter supporting your nomination.
We move together. Ang advocacy namin with the new government is to reach out to them na we are fully supportive of the new government. We know his track record in managing challenging situation.
Progressive group Migrante International has called on the incoming Migrant Workers Secretary Susan Tuts-Ople to promote programs that will encourage Filipinos to work in the country instead of leaving to pursue jobs abroad.
Nasa constitution kasi, 1987 constitution at nasa napakarami international standards na obligation ng gobyerno na magbigay, mag-provide ng jobs sa mismong loob ng bansa niya. At hindi dapat talaga maging patakaran at maging itulak ng mga gobyerno palabas ng kanyang mamamayan para kumita ng pera at ipadala doon sa ating bansa.
Joyce Balanso, ABS-CBN News.
The Regional Tripartite Wages and Productivity Board has approved a 50 peso wage hike in Eastern Visayas. This will raise the minimum wage in the region to 375 pesos from the current 325 pesos. The wage hike will be released in two tranches. The first will take effect 15 days upon publication in a general circulation newspaper. The second one will take effect in January next year. Domestic helpers are to enjoy an additional 500 pesos in their monthly wages. 14 other regions have implemented wage hikes this month. The Philippines logs close to 300 new COVID-19 cases Saturday. This is the highest daily increase in almost 2 months since April 20th. Officials also reported 151 new cases in Metro Manila. The country's death toll staying at over 50,000 or 60,000 with no new deaths recorded. The Philippine Capital Region's most populous city on alert amid rising COVID-19 cases, Quezon City has raised its alert status to yellow, indicating a possible surge in the coming weeks. The city's epidemiology chief, Dr. Rolly Cruz, attributing the rise to the public's non-compliance of health protocols. Cruz says there won't be granular lockdowns for now, but vows they will conduct aggressive contact tracing.
Because cases are low, it's easy to do contact tracing. That's what we're doing right now. And we are prepared to give the necessary assistance for those who are in home quarantine. And granular lockdown probably will be a last option at this time.
Cebu Governor Gwendolyn Garcia stands by her order to allow the lifting of masks outdoors. That's despite opposition from the Interior and Health Departments. Johnson Manabat reports.
The Philippine Health Department is calling all local chief executives to stick with existing pandemic health protocols. This comes after the Cebu Provincial Government allowed the lifting of face masks outdoors. Health Undersecretary Maria Rosario Vergere says only one protocol should be followed. Vergere points out other countries that prematurely lifted their face mask mandate experienced a surge in COVID-19 cases.
Kailangan po lahat ng local governments, lahat tayo, iisa lang ang protocol na susundin natin. Kailangan sabay-sabay tayo at magtulong-tulong so that lahat tayo mapupunta tayo at maaatim natin yung new normal na sinasabi natin.
Cebu Governor Gwen Garcia, however, sticking to her order lifting the use of face masks outdoors. That's despite objections from both the health and interior government departments. Garcia cites Section 105 of the local government code, which states that the DOH control only lasts 6 months during times of pandemic.
It's been 2 years, and I am ready now to test that. Local autonomy must prevail, especially since it is us who know what our situation here is.
The governor is confident that the COVID situation has eased because of mass vaccination. The Interior Department previously said the DALG does not recognize the executive order of Garcia because they have the interagency task force guidelines approved by the president. In a statement, Cebu City Police Provincial Office says it supports Garcia's executive order unless it is later invalidated by proper authority. Quirino Governor Dakila Carlo Cua also considering relaxing the outdoor face mask policy in his province. But he says he will consult with experts before following in Cebu's footsteps. Cua, who is also the president of the Union of Local Authorities of the Philippines, or ULAP, says the group has yet to discuss Cebu's latest move.
Wala pa kaming talagang survey or consultation na ginawa sa ating mga members para malaman talaga kung ilan bang sumusuporta. But definitely, a lot of local governments support local autonomy. But also, halos lahat naman talaga sumusuport naman talaga sa national government policy.
But according to the DOH, it is not yet time to ease the existing health protocols, especially with the new sub-variants of COVID-19. On Saturday, the Department of Health said Metro Manila posted a slight rise in terms of new COVID-19 cases in the past week, but said the uptick is not alarming.
The positivity rate has increased to 1.6% sa ngayon. Makikita po natin dito po sa NCR, out of the 17 areas, meron po tayong 14 na areas na may positive na growth rate. Mm-hmm. Ibig sabihin na dadagdagan po ang kaso, pero katulad nga ng sabi natin, hindi pa po siya ganun ka-significant.
Johnson Manabat, ABS-CBN News.
As officials say in Cagayan Valley, see no need to declare a dengue outbreak for now. That's as cases in the region soar by nearly 900% compared with last year. Dr. Grace Santiago explains many of the over 2,000 patients in the region have showed symptoms but are not yet confirmed dengue cases. She says the lack of testing kits will make it harder for them to manage the situation.
As of now, what the Department of Health is giving out is our rapid diagnostic test kits. All of these are given to our barangay level for them to differentiate if it is dengue or not. Mm-hmm. However, for the Zika and chikungunya, these are also mosquito-borne and probably harbored by the same species of mosquito. We do not have the testing kits available at the barangay or municipal level. If they have the same presentation and they tested negative for our dengue kits, we do not have a way of saying, is this the other kind of yes. mosquito-borne mm-hmm. diseases?
Over 100 families in Sorsogon town of Huban evacuated once more amid continued unrest from Mount Bulusan, this report. Over 100 families are currently staying in evacuation centers in Huban, Sorsogon. This after the local government of Huban implemented preemptive evacuation Friday afternoon following the unrest of Bulusan volcano. These families are temporarily housed in Tughan Evacuation Center and at the municipal gymnasium. Since it's only a preemptive evacuation, children, the elderly, and pregnant women are given priority.
Volcanic activity, kaya nagkaroon po tayo uli ng pag-evacuate ng ating mga kababayan. Hindi namin masasabi kung puputok ba siya, kung kailan siya puputok, kasi kumbaga unstable. So as of now, we are on continuous monitoring and naka-standby po tayo sa kalagayan ng Mount Bulusan.
Local authorities also on the lookout for the possible spread of diseases in the evacuation centers, including COVID-19.
Technically po kasi yung COVID symptoms ay very general siya. So depende sa age group, pwede mag-present ng diarrhea or mga upper respiratory tract infections, which is actually nakikita na din natin ngayon. So merong mga nag-exaggerate yung hika. Although mga minute lang din po sila and well-controlled. Pero yun, at the very least, alam natin na hindi or technically marurule out natin yung COVID.
The Philippine Institute of Volcanology and Seismology is closely monitoring the activity of the volcano. For the past 24 hours, FIVOX recorded 178 volcanic earthquakes around the area, indicating Bulusan's unrest. Authorities reiterate that entering the 4-kilometer permanent danger zone is strictly prohibited as the volcano is still on alert level 1. Up ahead, Shanghai officials order a new lockdown to test its residents for COVID-19. And the country's heroes honored in what seems to be an unlikely place. We'll tell you more about that when World Tonight returns after the break.
In this first of two parts on our recent visit to Palawan, we uncovered a secret that is Lihim, a new luxury resort nestled in a tropical forest on a mountain overlooking iconic Bakwit Bay. We'll enjoy the last days of sun before the rainy season begins under the canopy of trees, on the sands of the beach, and out at sea. In parts of El Nido, that only a few privileged guests ever get to see.
For back on the world tonight. Strong words from America's defense chief on China's military activity near Taiwan. Secretary Lloyd Austin calls Beijing's move provocative and destabilizing. His remarks come a day after his Chinese counterpart vowed China will fight at all costs over Taiwan. Tensions between Washington and Beijing have soared in recent months over Taipei. Austin reaffirms the U.S.'s commitment for peace and stability in the Taiwan Strait.
We see growing coercion from Beijing. We've witnessed a steady increase in provocative and destabilizing military activity near Taiwan. And that includes PLA aircraft flying near Taiwan in record numbers in recent months, and nearly on a daily basis. And we remain focused on maintaining peace, stability, and the status quo across the Taiwan Strait.
Dozens of new COVID infections are reported in China. Latest figures showed 36 of the 65 locally transmitted cases were from its capital, Beijing. 73 asymptomatic carriers also identified in regions including Inner Mongolia and Shanghai. Officials say 786 patients are also receiving treatment across the Chinese mainland. Shanghai returns to a brief lockdown this weekend. This as officials order a mass testing for the city's 25 million residents. The move follows the detection of new community cases in China's financial hub. It also comes just days after the city lifted its months-long lockdown. The move has stoked fears among residents, triggering a rush to grocery stores to stock up on supplies. The Golden State Warriors tied the series of the NBA Finals after taking Game 4 against the Boston Celtics 107-97. The Warriors' Stephen Curry poured in 43 points and then grabbed 10 rebounds. He was also instrumental in the 10-0 fourth quarter run, allowing the Dubs to take back the lead from Boston. Game 5 in the best-of-7 finals will be on June 14. That's Tuesday, Manila time. Back here at home, multi-awarded actress Nora Honor and veteran opera artist Fides Cuyuganacencio are finally declared as national artists for 2022 after years of being bypassed. Malacañang also honoring six other stalwarts of Philippine arts and culture. Mario Dumawal reports.
After 8 years of waiting, actress Nora Aunor was finally named as one of the 8 national artists by Malacañang Friday night. She is the recipient of the prestigious honor for film and broadcast arts. Along with screenwriter and novelist Ricardo Ricci Lee and the late director Marilu Diaz-Abaya. Other awardees are Agnes Locsin for dance, the late Salvation Lim Higgins for fashion design, Gemino Abad for literature, Fides Cuyuganacencio for music, and the late Antonio Tony Mabesa for theater. The new order of national artists is based on the joint recommendation of the National Commission for Culture and the Arts and the Cultural Center of the Philippines of exceptional Filipinos who have made distinct contributions to the development of Philippine arts and culture.
My brother is not a pig.
In her moment of vindication, Honor thanked her family and supporters who struggled to convince the awards jury that she deserves the honor. She was twice bypassed for the National Artist Award in 2014 and 2018. It is also a moment of triumph for the 91-year-old Asensio, who was nominated 4 times through the decades. She told ABS-CBN News, if there's one thing she learned from the long and tedious process of proclaiming national artists, it is never to give up. Asensio also thanked her supporters who stood by her. Lee also paid tribute to all his patrons who stood by him ever since he left his hometown in Daet to pursue his dream in Manila before martial law. Lee said he never stopped writing about the ironies of life to open the minds of the reading public. Locsin thanked all her dancers who embodied her vision as a choreographer to preserve and build up indigenous dancing. Meantime, the family of Higgins told ABS-CBN News
that the award will hopefully continue to inspire future generations of Filipino fashion designers. Veteran director Joel Lamangan also hailed the proclamation of his longtime friend Mabesa as national artist. He also said that his colleagues Lee, Abaya, and Aunor rightfully deserve the honors. The National Artist Awards will be conferred by Malacañang at a ceremony scheduled later this month. Mario Dumawal, ABS-CBN News.
Filipinos urged to visit historical monuments honoring the country's heroes. This as the nation is set to celebrate Independence Day on Sunday.
There are many places in the country that pay tribute to heroes who fought for Philippine independence. This include the Bonifacio Shrine in Caloocan, Aguinaldo Shrine in Cavite, the Heroes Park, and the Rizal Monument in Manila. But some of the beautiful and grand tributes to heroes can be found in one cemetery, the Himlayang Pilipino in Quezon City. Here, you can find this golden memorial for Melchora Aquino, or more popularly known as Tandang Sora. She was regarded as the mother of Katipunan, established to fight for the country's freedom from then Spanish colonizers. You can also find here murals of Teresa Magbanwa, known as the Visayan Joan of Arc, the Cry of Pugadlawin, Gabriela Silang, and Emilio Jacinto. The cemetery's management says this is their way of honoring the heroes who offered their lives in a bid to seek the country's independence.
Dito nila matutunghayan ang bawat detalye in a way ng mga history. Binibigyan namin sila ng actual preservation, physical preservation sa site sa pamamagitan ng pagpapanatili ng mga natural na disenyo ng ginawa ng mga skulptor.
The National Historical Commission of the Philippines hopes more Filipinos, especially the young ones, will visit monuments of the country's heroes.
I-encourage pa rin natin ang ating mga kabataan na bisitahin itong mga monumento na to para mabuhay sa atin yung pagpapakabayani bilang Pilipino. Itong mga monumento na to nagpapaalala na tayo din pwedeng maging bayani on our own way.
Our final word tonight is a quote from John Philpot Curran. The price of freedom is eternal vigilance. And that's the world tonight, the 11th of June, 2022. I'm Stanley Palisada from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay.